Hi guys, hope you all would have enjoyed seeing the animation for the introduction of Faces of Compiler. So every compiler has its own fixed number of faces to convert the source level language to machine level language. So it's a kind of logical unit synthesized. So instead of transforming the high level language to the low level language in a stretch, it will be divided into several phases, several segments, or several logical units. Each logical unit supposed to carry out certain tasks in the transmission of high level language to target level language or machine level language. In simple, what is the meaning of high level language is anything we write in a programming language like English form, like C language, C program, C++, Java program, these all termed as high level languages. How this high level language is translated or converted into machine readable form or exe file, zeros and ones. In general, high level language we used to write C or C++ or Java or Python. Name it. It is a structured programming language or functional language or an object-oriented programming language or a scripting language. There are four types of high-level language exist. Languages. Number one, structured programming language. Example C. Number two, object-oriented language. It's example C++. 3. Bytecodes, otherwise said to be virtual programming. Bytecodes, it's converted into bytecodes. Example, best example is Java. Next, 4. Interpreted language. Example Python, we can say. Number 5, scripting language. For the scripting language, HTML, JavaScript, PHP, these all example for scripting language. Even Python itself can be treated as a scripting language also, object-oriented programming language also, as well as interpreted language also. These are all the forms of high-level language. 4 types of high-level language we need to understand. So finally, the role of compiler is what? Translating or converting these are all the high level language into exe files, or in terms we can say executable codes, or we can say machine language, machine readable format or machine language. Ultimately, it is going to be in the form of zeros and once. This is what the role of compiler, starting with high level language and translating into low level language. Now the question is, why the compiler? So this compiler only predominantly doing the role of translating high level language to this low level language. Instead of doing at a stretch, it is undergoing into several logical phases. That is why it is termed as phases. Even for the purpose of human understanding how the compiler works, how the functionality of the compiler, also for the machine to translate this high level language to this low level language, it needs to be programmed stages or logical units. These are all said to be high level compiler or high level language to machine level language translation. Now let us see introduction. This introduction starts with, it's a compiler operates in various phases. Each and every phase starts transforming the source code into machine readable form. Every phase takes input from the previous phase and it does delta changes or incremental changes, a partial changes from the previous phase input to the next phase. It passes on with a modification. So with that gradual modification, finally the high level language is converted into machine level language or zeros and forms or executable languages. Now, there are six major phases involved in phases of compiler: lexical analysis phase, syntactic analysis phase, semantic analysis phase, and intermediate code generator, code optimizer, code generator. Throughout the syllabus of compiler design, it is going to be understood each and every phases, every phase in detailed manner. Nothing to worry right now. Now, it's an introductory part. It is given right now in this video. Now, these six major phases are broadly categorized into two phases, that is called analysis phase or synthesis phase. Otherwise also it is called front end. It is called front end. The same analysis phase is termed as front end. And this synthesis phase is termed as back end. These are all the possible terminologies used in the compiler design textbook or in the technical world. These phases are majorly divided into analysis phase or synthesis phase or front end and back end. The meaning of analysis phase, it is language dependent. That means it is source language dependent, machine independent. What is the meaning of machine independent? It is independent from the machine architecture, machine instructions, machine. The moment we call machine dependent, it is related to hardware component of the machine, CPU, memory organization, and the availability of instructions, flags, counters, and registers. The moment we say machine dependent, it's all related to CPU, the power of execution, and the primary memory RAM, and memory organization, and availability of registers and counters, also a flag. The moment we start studying about programming counter and registers, memory organization, primary memory organization, memory fetching, memory segmentation, and the CPU, flags, and stack organization, including stack also. The moment we discuss these all, then it is termed as machine dependent. The second phase or the back end is dependent on the machine architecture. Whereas the first front end or the analysis phase, we no need to worry about the architecture of the machine or the type of the machine or the availability of register and its types and availability of flags and its types, availability of counters and its functionality, stack memory, RAM memory, the pattern of CPU execution, we no need to worry. So that is what here we are going to discuss in these two phases. The primary analysis phase is highly dependent on the language, the source language. How much effort we may need to do or we need to work on the source language is termed as analysis phase. How much effort or work we need to do in the subsequent phase, synthesis phase, is said to be machine dependent. Now let's move to the diagrammatic or schematic representation of these phases. There are six major phases we have seen: lexical analyzer, syntax analyzer, semantic analyzer, intermediate code generator, code optimizer, code generator. These are all the six major phases. In addition, there are two phases common to all the phases. It will be interacting commonly with all the phases. It is essential for throughout the compilation process. From the beginning to the end, these are all the two phases common. Number one, it is symbolic table manager. Number two, error handler. We will see what is the meaning of symbolic table manager and error manager. Although we say six phases are important, there are two more additional phases that is also equally important, but these two phases are common to all the phases. Whereas these six phases, the original source program is fed to lexical analyzer. Source program is fed to the lexical analyzer. Then the source program is translated into different format by lexical analyzer, then syntax analyzer, semantic analyzer. Each phase does its own functionality and the transformed output of that phase is fed as input to the next phase. Subsequently, this phase carries certain roles and certain functionalities and it translates the obtained input into different form. That form is fed to the subsequent phase. Finally, it comes in the form of the output of code generator would become the machine readable format or machine code, executable code. This is how it works. In the process of this translation, there are two phases commonly supports throughout the compilation process. Number one is symbol table. Number two is error handler. Now let us see the very first phase we are going to discuss about it. That is lexical analysis phase. What the role of lexical analysis phase? Let us go. The role of lexical analysis phase is to find out the token. The meaning of token, I tell you. In day-to-day life itself, we will be articulating. Hi, everybody. Now, when we read, we focus on word level. Hi, we will look at. Everybody, we look at. We try to understand the word level, what it signifies, and is there any spelling mistake or not, whether it is in the right context or not, every word is right or not, whether it is noun or verb, or we will be finding out whether it is preposition, adverb, something like that. So this is how human readable language also will be doing. We will be working on the word level. The similarly, in the programming language also, looking at the word level of the program is termed as token. Token is a sequence of character. In the case of hi, everybody also, hi is a sequence of character. Whereas the moment we look at in the technical perspective, the moment we say token, for example, we will be writing hash include. Subsequently, we will be including stdio.h as a header file. This word is termed as sequence of character. Hash include would become a sequence of characters. It is termed as a token. It will be treated as a single entity. So it will be trying to translate that entity level, single entity level. That identification of each and every single entity is the primary role of lexical analysis. Now what it does, it will recognize each and every single entity and it will be broadly categorized and recognized into these five categories. What are all that five categories? Whether that recognized token is of identifier. What is the meaning of identifier? It is a user-defined naming convention for the variable or for the functions. Anywhere users are given the privilege to coin their user-defined name, all the user-defined names used in the programs are termed as identifiers. For example, variables, example for identifiers, constant name. Declaration. Constant declaration is example for identifier. Name of the user-defined function invoked in the program is example for identifiers. Next is keyword. Then identified pattern or the token, it will treat or it will classify as keywords or operators. Within the operator, we have a lot of categories. Logical operators, bitwise operators, and we have the category called arithmetic operators and special operators, something like that. Then special symbols, it will identify whether it is special symbol or not, and constants, it will treat it as a constant. Majorly these five, some of the language will have much more than these five categories also, especially C, we have these are all the five categories. Then what is the meaning of pattern? Token is broadly is treated as a sequence of characters that can be treated as a single entity. That single entity may belong to any one of this category, either identifier category or keywords category or operators category or special symbols or constants category. Subsequently, we may need to be aware of what is pattern. Set of strings in the input which for which the same token is produced as output. That is the meaning of pattern, but we will be articulating in terms of English about the pattern. That pattern is kind of defining in the human language what is a pattern. We used to say it is a pattern of so and so, it is a pattern of images, it is a pattern of music, something like that. It has certain pattern. Let's see. Finally, match with the pattern is termed as lexic. Through example, perhaps you can understand much better. Let us see. Constant is a token. Lexeme is a constant. Pattern is a constant. When we can say constant, whenever we find a token constant. followed by anything is given. Const max equal to 50. In this scenario, let us see. Int, especially C language, max is equal to 50. In which the moment it finds integer, it is treated as a keyword. So it will be treated as keyword. Next, it finds the token const. It will be treated as a constant. Then the moment it finds max, it is treated as identifier. Then the moment it finds equal to symbol, assignment operator. The moment it finds 50, this becomes a constant. Then it is going to become lexeme. This lexeme is going to become 50. Then what is pattern? Pattern is anything followed by constant and having a constant identifier, then followed by a value which is assigned, then it is the pattern. So it has a pattern for the categorization, that is the meaning of pattern. Next, if. If is the token. What is the lexeme? If. Pattern is what? If. That's it. If consists of two letters, two characters. It's a keyword. That's it. Relational operator. It is a token. Then what are the possible patterns would occur within the category relational operator, less than or equal to? What are all the lexemes? The outcome of the pattern or the identified token will become the lexeme. Similarly, identifier. Through this, perhaps you can understand much better what is this different, what is the difference between pattern, lexeme, and token. Identifier is the token. Pattern is what? Letter followed by letter or digit or underscore. Look at the very first category. What we are looking at is A. This is a variable. That is called letter. Then letter followed by letters or digit or underscore. The second one. Number one is another variable or identifier. Total sum followed by underscore. It can be a capitalized letter also. It can be uppercase letter also. These are all the combinations can be termed as a lexeme. Now through this example, hope you can understand. Token is identifier. For the token, we may need to articulate. That is called pattern. Finally, the recognized items are said to be lexeme. Whatever the user tend to use in the program, that becomes the lexeme. With this introduction, let us move to detailed discussion of lexical analysis. Lexical analysis is the phase, scans the source program. The very primary duty of lexical analysis is to scan the source program. What are all the way the source program can be scanned? Buffering technique, that all we will be discussing in the subsequent chapters. Now let us understand the primary purpose of lexical analysis is only for scanning the code, user code. That you will be writing a program first.c. The scanning the program called first.c is the primary role of lexical analysis. This process can be left to right, character by character, and group these characters into tokens. Token identification is the first process. When we read any paragraph, even what I am reading here also, we are doing the process called tokenization. But in the human language, we don't use the terminology tokenization. We will be telling that read the word. That's it. Similarly, in the computer programming, reading that parts or entity of the programming is said to be lexical analysis. Identify the lexical units in the source program. Classify that whether it belongs to identifier or constant or keyword or reserved word and operators or special characters, etc. And another primary role of lexical analysis is finding out all the comment lines, multiple comment line or single comment line, ignoring those comment lines in the source program. In the next phase of the compilation process itself, it will start ignoring. In the lexical phase itself, those comment lines will be avoided. All the single line comment and multiple line comments are avoided. Identifying token which are not the part of programming language also. Single line comment and multiple line comment, multi-line comment, comments, single line comments, all are identified and ignored by the lexical analyzer. That is the primary role carried out along with the token recognition. The next, for example, consider this simple arithmetic evaluation. X is equal to y plus 10. In this equation or in this statement, available tokens are how many, how it recognizes. It starts from left to right associativity or scanning. The very first instance or entity would become X. X is recognized as an identifier. It is one of the token. Next, it moves on. It identifies this equal to symbol. It is said to be assignment operator. This becomes second token. Then it moves on to the third component or entity or instance, that is Y. It is treated as identifier by the compiler or the lexical analyzer. Then it moves on to the next symbol, that is plus. Then it is treated as an addition operator. It moves on to the last component, that is 10. It is treated as a number or integer. So these are all the way it starts functioning, scanning of the given source program. Now, output of the lexical analysis is fed to the syntactic analyzer. Now, what is the role of syntactic analyzer? Let us discuss in this part, in which discovering the major constructs, that is structure of a programming code. In a code, it finds out the structure. What is the meaning of structure? Declaration section, conditional statement, looping statement, function declaration, function definition, function call, identifying the major structure of the program or construct of the program is the role of syntactic analyzer. Not only identifying the major construct, also it identifies the correctness of the construct. How it is possible? The scanning and the token identification or statement identification or major construct identification is the question now or food for thought. Now you need to think how these are all functioning. Just now we have completed lexical analysis. This also does the token identification. How it is possible to identify the token? You would have studied in your formal language subject. It is called regular grammar. This regular grammar is the concept helps for identifying the token. The entire lexical analysis process is based on the regular language or regular grammar, regular expressions. These are all the concepts, abstract mathematical notions. These are all entire theory of computation or formal languages are termed as abstract mathematical views or concepts. So those are all the concepts helpful for carry this entire functionality of this lexical analysis. Without this grammar, it is not possible for analysis. Similarly, how this syntactic analysis is possible? The entire part of the syntactic analysis is based on CFG, context-free grammar. Context-free grammar only helps for completing the task of syntactic analysis, the phase of recognizing the major construct or verifying syntactic correctness, the or understanding syntax of the language and translating syntax to the machine-readable form. These are all possible by context-free grammar. Let us see. Discovering the structure is a major phase. For that, set of rules are helpful for recognizing the construct of the program. For that, parse tree also helps. The moment you study context-free grammar, all along you will be doing parse tree also. That parse tree and the context-free grammar together determines the structure of the source language. That is the primary role. Now, what it does, let us see. Obtain tokens from the lexical analyzer. Once the token level is or correct, checks if the expression is syntactically correct or not. How do we write if statement in C program? We do write if A is greater than 10, close bracket. If we try to put semicolon, it is error. This error is detected. This semicolon will not be treated as error, whereas in the lexical analysis phase, because reading that semicolon, it will treat it as terminator symbol. that symbol is permitted to use in the C programming language, so no error will be notified in the lexical analysis phase. Whereas the same semicolon is indicated as an error in the syntactic analysis phase because each statement does not end with semicolon. So these kind of higher level construct syntactic verification is carried out by the syntactic analyzer phase. It will report the error, construct a hierarchical structure which is known as parse tree. We'll be discussing in detail how to recognize whether the given statement is right or not using context-free grammar and parse tree in the second unit. Just here we are discussing the introductory part of these all terminologies and the overview of each and every phase. For the same example, x is equal to y plus 10. How the parse tree is constructed, how it recognizes the statement is correct or not. Let us see. A plus B into C, it is synthesized into star. The root of the parse tree is preferred with the highest precedence operator. I mean, these two operators, star becomes the highest precedence. So it starts with a star. Then A plus B, it goes with plus in the intermediate node, and A and B would become leaf node or child node. C would become child node of the start root node. The interior node always will be enabled with the operator field. Leaf node always it would become either single token or two tokens, either one field or two field. Normally it would be an identifier or it would be a constant. The leaf node would become either identifier or constant or integers. Then ensure that components of the program fit together meaningfully. Yes, when we start evaluating this expression, A is given as a value to this operator. B is also one of the operand. This operator will perform on both of the operand A plus B. The result would be folded or available in this node. Then with this result, C is also an operand to the operator star. Then it evaluates the multiplication of these two. So it logically sounds well. So through the parse tree, this evaluation happens. Now let us see. After the syntactic verification, the output is passed on to the next phase. It is termed as semantic analyzer. What it does? It verifies most of the time compatibility issues and the consistency of the code issues, match of the right-hand side assignment to the left-hand side assignment. For example, we used to receive a value in the float variable after doing our arithmetic operations on integer variables and the constants. So those are all the compatibility match and the consistency match are verified by the semantic analyzer. Arguments, matching of the argument, formal parameter, actual parameter. We used to pass the value from actual parameter to the formal parameters. By that situation, whether that type match is correct or not, all the type matches in simple term, we can say type match. Type match is carried out by semantic analyzer. Now let us see. In this case, float x is equal to 20.2. Float y is equal to x into 30. In this case, integer 30 need to be converted as 30.2. Because 30 is the type representation called integer. So it is becoming mixed mode. X is assigned with the value float value 20.2. Then the operation is invoked with the float and integer mixed mode. Result is also assigned to float variable. In such a scenario, how to convert the entire expression compatible to the operand y, the variable y? So this conversion of this is implicit conversion. When the user is not giving appropriate data type for the expression evaluation, certain things are carried out by the compiler itself. That is called implicit conversion. When the user is doing explicitly, then it becomes explicit conversion. There are two types of conversions possible in every programming language, implicit and explicit conversion. Now, after these all inconsistency check, and if it is free from all the type mismatches, then it will be passed on to the intermediate code. What is the meaning of intermediate code? The high level language is translated in terms of intermediate code representation. These intermediate code representations are categorized into three address code representation, quadruple code representation, indirect three address code representation. There are several types we will be discussing. Now let us look at the translation of intermediate code. Consider this expression, total equal to count plus rate into 5. This is the given expression. How this is translated into intermediate code? Let us look at. This is called address code method. What it does is int to float. It is converting int to float 5. This is almost a kind of semantic analyzer. That semantic analyzer output is also passed on to this code. Now, the entire largest statement is decomposed into smaller steps. Now, in this expression, very first code is type conversion. This 5 is converted into float data type that is stored in temporary variable. These temporary variable generation is also the role of intermediate code generation. T1 is generated automatically by the compiler during the intermediate code generation process. Next, since star is the highest precedence operator among these two operator, this expression is computed first, rate into T1. Subsequently, the result is stored in T2. Then count is left out operand and plus operation need to be performed. So count and the temporary result T2 together evaluated here. Once again, it is stored in another temporary variable T3. Finally, the temporary variable T3 is assigned to the total variable after the completion of expression evaluation. This is what the process carried out by the largest expression is divided into several sub-expressions that also has its own characteristics of synthesize. That synthesis process is called three address code, quadruple address code. These are all those things we'll be discussing in the subsequent chapters. So now, in this process, we understood that during the intermediate code generation, lot of temporary variables are generated by the phase. With the support of temporary variable, it starts evaluating stage by stage, step by step. The same intermediate code generation finds out the first expression need to be evaluated. Among all the expression, first type conversion is prior, because semantic analyzer deducts these all the type mismatches and fixes there. If it is notified as error, it will notify. If not, it go for implicit conversion. That is why the very first operation is carried out with implicit conversion. This is notified by the semantic analyzer. There is a type mismatch, so it needs to be translated or converted into float data type so that it is given as a highest priority. Subsequently, star is the next priority evaluation. Last is plus is the last priority evaluation. Finally, the answer is assigned after the computation. Now, code optimization. What is the meaning of code optimization? For example, in the same evaluation, is there any possibility of optimizing, reducing the code? Either in terms of memory utilization or speed of execution. The optimization is carried out for the major purpose of memory utilization or with the CPU execution. Is there any possibility or provision of improving the speed of the execution, or is there any provision for reducing the memory utilization? For example, generation of intermediate variable. Is there any possibility of reducing the number of variables? And how quickly we can execute this code? How minimal code could be generated for the source language? These are all the tasks carried out in the phase called code optimization. It helps to establish a trade-off between execution and compilation speed, improves the running time of the target code, and generates streamlined code still in intermediate representation, removing unreachable code, removing statements which are not altered from the loop. So we will be discussing in the fourth unit what are all the way the code is optimized. Nothing to worry right now. Look at this scenario. Through the example, you can try to understand this concept easily. A is equal to into float 10, B is equal to C into A, D is equal to E plus B, F is equal to D. Imagine this is the output from the intermediate code generation. How this could be optimized? So B is equal to C into 10.0. Instead of converting into float, C into A, the code is rewritten by this optimizer, code optimizer, C into 10.0. With this expression evaluation, the result is going to become E plus B. This result is substituted here, B and E. Instead of these four steps, it is reduced into a single step. This process is called intermediate code optimization. Let us go to the code generation. Finally, register allocation, appropriate register allocation, and ready for the executable code memory or executable code and how it is to be loaded into the executable code memory. These are all the notions considered in code generation. It is a last phase. Ultimately, code generation is final step of execution process. The moment code generation is ready, the executable code will be loaded into executable code memory. Now in this case, A is equal to B plus 60. Imagine one code at a time it converts, and A is equal to B plus 60. In this one operand, one constant and receiving variable or resultant variable, these are all the constructs available in the given syntax. So first, R A is loaded into R1, move A to R1, 60 to R2, add R1 to R2, so that from R1 the result is moved on to A. So these are all the way it is translated into. It's otherwise called assembly code. It translates high level language into assembly code for any given construct. This is the last step. Now let us come to symbol table management. What is the role of symbol table management? Constant, all the identifiers, name of the function, all the user defined components, user defined variables or user defined naming conventions, everything will be stored into the symbol table. During the intermediate code generation also, the symbol table is taken into consideration by the intermediate code generator, code optimizer, for the references. And any variable or any identifier is created, every identifier and the variables are resided or kept it or stored in the symbol table for the future references. The moment declaration is done in the programming language, symbol table will have an entry of all the variables which is given in the declaration section, along with the several attributes like data type, size of that particular variable, or how much memory location need to be allocated, scope of the variable, etc. Subsequently, whenever in the executable code section, those all the variables are repeated, then it will search the symbol table and it will retrieve the data quickly. For that, quick retrieval, hashing technique, or linked list technique, there are tree structure technique will be used. Subsequently, we will be discussing symbol table management or data structures used for symbol table construction. Always, symbol table helps for scope management, whether that variable is of local or static or global, that is external or external or stack. These are all the considerations or register. So which memory need to be used or which way the scope of the variable is working, that all those information together, it will keep it in the symbol table. Finally, error handling routine. Lexical analyzer, wrongly spelled keyword. For example, the appropriate declaration for the float variable is float. Instead, typo mistake or unknowingly doing FLAOT. This is said to be wrong. This is identified as wrong variable or a wrong construct or entity. So this is detected by lexical analyzer. Similarly, syntactic analyzer, missing parenthesis or semicolon using in the if statement when it is of C programming language, the entire syntactic correctness is verified by syntactic analyzer. Intermediate code generator and subsequently semantic code generator, semantic analyzer does the inconsistency check. Intermediate code generator, it does mismatched operands for an operator. For example, plus operator, you can give a plus b to operand. Both must be either integer or float or long or short integer, double. These are all the possible data types. We cannot give string data type. For example, if we declare character a of 10. In such scenario, a is not permitted in this operator, plus operation. Or for example, a divided by b. These are all the operations not permitted. So this check is carried out by intermediate code generator. Code optimizer, it will reduce or it will improve the speed of the execution or reduce the memory consumption. And when the statement is not reachable, what is the meaning of not reachable? Whenever the programming construct is written with a switch case or control statement or looping statement, it must appropriately exit for true condition also, false condition also. When it is not exiting from those, these are all the real-time cases we can elicit for code optimizer or not reachable codes. Unreachable statements, there are few statements, never ever it will reach or it will be terminated. Symbol table, always multiple declaration is identified by the symbol table manager. We try to declare int a, subsequently unknowingly we will try to declare float a also. Multiple declaration is not permitted. Similarly, undeclared identifiers are detected in the program, that is also notified by symbol table manager or error handler. When that symbol is not available in the symbol table, multiple entries are available in the program, those are all notified by error handling with respect to symbol table management. This error handler is also common to all the phases, lexical, syntactic, semantic, intermediate, code optimizer, code generator, symbol table, all the phases it is commonly functioning. Finally, we discussed various phases of compiler in this video. The number of phases which we discussed are 6 phases, lexical, syntactic, semantic, intermediate, code optimizer and code generator. For all the 6 phases, the common phases are symbol table manager, error handler. These are all the 2 routine commonly works for all the phases. Syntactic analysis, all about discovering structure of the statement or a structure of the program. Then semantic analyzer, always useful for inconsistency or type mismatch detection or recovery. Next is code generator, intermediate code generator. It will be generating code suitable for the target machine. Code optimization always removes the unnecessary code or lines. These are all the roles carried out. Lexical analyzer does the entire scanning of the program, ignoring the comment line and verifying the appropriateness of the tokens. Next, symbol table always stores the record for all the identifiers along with several fields. Those fields are filled with the scope and the size and the values, etc. Error handler routine detects the occurrences of error throughout the compilation process. With this, you can keep watching towards the next video. Thank you all.